Ladies and gentlemen, the more perceptive among you will have noticed that I am not Lord Hoffman. I have neither his intellectual power nor his charisma. I am not a judge, I am a politician. And it is in that role, as Lord Chancellor and Secretary of State for Justice, that I wanted, first of all, to thank you for coming here at the launch of what I consider to be one of the most important pieces of work carried out by any think tank or any academic institution in Britain today. Today is the launch of Policy Exchange's Judicial Power project. The reason why Lord Hoffman, I know, wanted to be here, the reason why I'm so glad to be here, is there can be no more important constitutional question at the moment for all of us than making sure that we plot the borderlines, the porous and flexible borderlines, but the important borderlines between executive, legislature and judiciary in a way that safeguards our freedoms, respects the rule of law and is true to the constitutional principles that have for centuries made these islands a beacon of liberty. We're in the middle of a debate, I should know, about our relationship with other European nations. But underpinning the question about how Britain should relate to other nations constitutionally is the essential question of how our constitution should be fixed. How can we ensure that there is proper respect for judicial decision-making, an appropriate regard for legislative intention, an appropriate freedom of maneuver for the executive, and yet at the same time, how can we ensure that all three constituent parts of our constitution, which, as we will hear from Professor Finnis, represent in their different ways the spirit of past, present, and future, are held in balance. We're uniquely fortunate in having Professor Finnis here to address us. I say that for two reasons. The first is that I have read his lecture. The second is that I know that he's probably the most distinguished philosopher of law operating in any jurisdiction today. A student of H.L.A. Hart, someone who in his work on natural law has broken new ground and at the same time revived old traditions. The clarity of his thinking, the intellectual power and the moral force of his writing helped rewrite the way in which so many of us regard law and our duties towards the rule of law. Sadly, I now have to depart, because the reason why I'm speaking rather than Lord Hoffman is that all of us, whether we are Secretaries of State for Justice or whether we are backbenchers, are ultimately powerless in the face of the most powerful man in the British Constitution, the Chief Whip of the Parliamentary Party. And the Chief Whip's told me there's a vote at 7 o'clock, and if I'm not there, it doesn't matter how long I've been Secretary of State for Justice, if I'm not there, I won't be for a second longer. But having had the opportunity of reading this lecture, I know that you're in for a treat, and I hope that it will be the beginning of a debate in the minds of those here and in the life of the country, which I'm delighted the Policy Exchange has embarked on, delighted that John Finnis is here to inaugurate, and particularly delighted that Richard Eakins, a friend of mine and a protege of John's, is here to act as convener for. As I put the stage and as John goes to the lectern, Richard will take his place in the chair, and it will be Richard who will act as the quizmaster and master of ceremonies in my absence. Thank you all for coming. Thank you, John, for your work in the past and for your lecture, which I know everyone here will very, very much enjoy. Thank you.
Well, it's a privilege to address you. I was going to say, Lord Chancellor, I say to his parting note, judges, ladies and gentlemen. And I'm grateful to Policy Exchange not only for arranging all this, but also for choosing, quite without any input from me, to have it here in Gray's Inn Hall. As we came in, we all passed the statue of Francis Bacon. One of his essays is on judicature, or as my title puts it, judicial power, and I'll go back to that. When I first came to Gray's Inn as a student member and started keeping terms by eating dinners here in this hall in late 1962. Soon after my arrival in Oxford from Australia to write a doctoral thesis on the idea of judicial power, I didn't know it was Bacon's statue. Bacon enrolled here at the age of 15 and was a bencher, one of the Inn's governing high table members, by the age of 25 in 1586. Something scarcely possible today, even if, like him, you've been educated at Trinity College, Cambridge, by the master himself. One Gray's Inn Square, the address of my first chambers through the northern wall of the hall here, became a residence of his for the rest of his life. Well, in 1594, among many other activities in public and semi-public life, Bacon was much involved in directing the exceptional Christmas-type revels, culminating in the New Year with his device, a set of mainly political and philosophical declamations to bring closure to the rule of errors and confusions proclaimed by the rebels' mock king to have arisen on and after the Feast of the Holy Innocents, 28th of December, 1594, when right here, in a hall looking essentially the same then as it does now, students, barristers and their lady friends watched what will have been the first performance of Shakespeare's Helter Skelter, Tour de Force, full of lawyers' talk, the Comedy of Errors. There's much in the play, especially its opening and closing scenes, suggesting that Shakespeare intended it to enact a joyful reconciliation between the two great parties in an English nation, not to mention Gray's Inn, lethally divided by religion. And within that vision, he imagines and enacts a transformation of inexplicably rigorous penal law by an act of entirely gratuitous executive mercy. Earlier in 1594, Bacon once again was passed over in favour of Edward Cook, who in 1592 had been preferred to him as Solicitor General and now was preferred as Attorney General. The two men were rivals for and in the highest legal and judicial offices for 30 years. In 1613, Bacon, as at last Attorney General, secured Cook's wholly unwilling transfer from the office of Chief Justice of the Common Pleas to the less well-remunerated and less professionally prestigious, though higher office of Chief Justice of the King's Bench, which could hear appeals in error from Common Pleas. And in 1616, Attorney General Bacon secured Cook's removal from judicial office altogether for, as Bacon advised the King, his, Cook's, perpetual turbulent carriage towards His Majesty's prerogative royal and the branches thereof, and likewise towards all the settled jurisdictions of the King's courts. Then in turn, it was Cook, now once again an MP, who led the committee organising Bacon's impeachment and dismissal by the King and Lords from all his public offices, notably as Lord Chancellor and Chief Judge in Chancery. Well, by 1621, the year of his fall, these turbulent men, each having exercised the highest judicial power, had laid foundations. Bacon for the explosive rise of experimental natural science, and Cook for some defining features of the British Constitution, and indeed of any choice-worthy constitution. Cook's judgment in 1607 in Prohibition's Del Roy was foundational for the separation of executive from judicial power, and his leading part in the advisory opinion of England's four senior judges in the case of proclamations in 1610 was foundational for the separation of executive from legislative power. The problems about the nature and reach of judicial power, about which Bacon and Cook disagreed, are with us today. In forms much shifted in occasion and location, but recognisably the same. Permanent problems capable, it seems, of only provisional rather than permanent solutions. Well, I didn't get to the bottom of those problems in my thesis. After much about theories of government and powers and about the history of constitution making in America and Australia, outlined at this point in the text of this lecture, that the whole lecture will be available as you leave, and so I will leave out the sections of the lecture. I talk about it as the text. It's not compulsory to take away a copy of the text. I examined each of the many decisions after the history and theory, each of the many decisions of Australia's highest court, the High Court, interpreting that constitution's division and, as the court held, separation of powers, in particular of judicial power. Many able judges over more than 60 years made intense efforts to say just what judicial power is. These efforts seemed to me, at the end, to come down to two distinct but interlocked features: final resolution of disputes between parties by application of pre-existing law to established facts. But the Australian judges' efforts also yielded a paradox. The body of legal doctrine, that is, the constitutional law, resulting from their interpretation of the constitution's phrase, judicial power of the Commonwealth, could not truly be said to have been an application of pre-existing law. It was rather a doctrine imposed on the Constitution in 1915 by a 3-2 majority of the High Court, followed thereafter on the basis of precedent by virtually every judge down to today. And the two leading judgments imposing it were by justices who, as members of the 1898 convention that drafted the Constitution, had strenuously argued for precisely the position they adopted on the bench 17 years later, even though that position was rejected by big majorities in the convention. I tell the story briefly in my text. For me, it was a formative experience to discover in the Oxford libraries these rotten foundations of the Australian judicial doctrine of separation of powers, so magisterially insisted upon by the Chief Justice of Australia, Sir Owen Dixon, during the years of my Australian legal education. The title of this lecture summarises an understanding I don't think I adequately grasped after 3 years' doctoral study in Oxford. Past, present, and future captures a good deal of the truth, I think, about the distinctions between judicial, executive, and legislative powers. Powers that are each to be understood, moreover, as fundamentally responsibilities of office, figure. Focusing on the judicial component of the triad, I've set out my understanding of the issues in 10 theses. My text tries to illustrate each of them just a little. So first, the judicial responsibility is to adjudicate between parties who are in dispute about their legal rights and obligations by applying to facts admitted or agreed between them or found by the court after trial, by applying the law that defined those rights and obligations at that time past when the matter of their dispute arose. The court's judgment identifies and applies the legal commitments the community should be judged to have made to each of the parties now before the court, and made by the time they came into conflict with each other about the content or applicability of those commitments past. The legislature's responsibility is to make new or amended public commitments about private rights and public powers for the future. The executive's is to carry out those commitments, both as defined by the legislature and as adjudged enforceable by the courts, and, respectful of that constitutional and legal framework, to do what is here and now in the present required to protect the community's common good so far as that depends on measures that cannot reasonably be provided for by legislation or a way to whatever be reasonably submitted to adjudication, past, future, present. Bacon's essay of judicature, or the office and responsibility of a judge, as he makes clear in his Latin version of the essay, begins and almost ends by calling upon judges to abstain from lawmaking or from disturbing the established boundaries of rights and properties, the landmarks, as he puts it, and to be content with their high responsibility and right of prerogative of interpreting and applying the laws, not novelties. But far from being against novelties, Bacon himself urged over 2 decades that extensive law reform and ambitious rationalisation of England's chaotic common and statutory law be undertaken. only not in the exercise of judicial power. So, second thesis, to state, like Bacon and countless much longer serving judges, he only lasted 3 years as judge in Chancery, to state that the common law is declared rather than made is no mere fairy tale, as Lord Reed liked to put it in the 1970s, unless the statement is mistakenly asserted or heard as a description of the history of the common law, but is not a description, nor a prediction, but a statement of judicial responsibility. To identify the rights of the contending parties now by identifying what were in law the rights and wrongs or validity and invalidity of their actions and transactions when entered upon and done. In my text, I discuss this thesis at some length, especially in connection with a case in 1998 where the common law was developed in a significant way by the law lords, but with nuances based on a firm distinction between legislative and judicial action, nuances insisted upon by a narrow majority, including Lords Gough and Hoffman. So speaking tonight, I must reluctantly press on to the third thesis, that this hard cases make bad law, that saying, means hard cases tend to make bad law qua as law for the future. Judicial efforts to reform even the common law are often unproductive or counterproductive. The law is an ass is sometimes a consequence of judges thinking that their predecessor's law is an ass. Well, let me show that. Here's a paradigm, a model case, of the Baconian conception of the relation between judicial and legislative power in practice. In 1975, a powerful panel of five law lords decided unanimously that judges had for a century or more been wrongly convicting people of the common law offence of attempting, by actions more than merely preparatory, attempting to commit an offence which, in the circumstances, could not have been successfully committed. For example, convicting people of attempting to steal when the pockets they were picking were in fact empty, to their surprise and disappointment. No one, the reforming law lords said, can be found guilty for attempting the impossible. To punish such attempts is to punish people not for their acts, but for their mere intentions. Convicting pickpockets for picking empty pockets with intent to steal means that if a man comes across his enemy's corpse, thinks he's asleep, and stabs him in the heart, he could be convicted of attempted murder. The law, said the law lord's intellectual leader, Lord Reed, the law may sometimes be an ass, but it cannot be so asinine as that. 3 years later, another powerful panel of the law lords reaffirmed that liberal reform and extended it to the law of conspiracy. According to the common law, as meant to be purified by the 1975 decision, you cannot be guilty of conspiracy to produce the prohibited drug cocaine, say, if, unknown to you all, the powders you agree to process could never actually yield cocaine. The 1975 Lord's Decision's doctrine, that you are to be judged according to the facts as they happen to be, not according to the facts as you believed and intended them to be, was ringingly reaffirmed by Lord Scarman for the whole panel, even though a statute had already come into force since the trial of the convicted conspirators in that case, to ensure that in future conspiracies would be tried on the facts as believed and intended by the conspirators to be. Lord Reed's claim that adopting the would-be criminal's point of view in assessing his actions would make the law an ass was quoted with approval, even though the judges knew that Parliament had already adopted, in relation to future conspiracies, a position which fairly obviously implies that it was the law lords in 1975 who were making the law an ass. The law lords having thus doubled down in 1978, Parliament acted again in 1981, and once again after extensive scholarly discussion, and more especially a report and draft bill from the Law Commission responsible for advising Parliament about desirable law reforms. The clear intent and effect of the 1977 and 1981 statutes is summarised in a draft criminal code proposed by the Law Commission in 1989. A person may be guilty of conspiracy or attempt to commit an offence, although the commission of the offence is impossible, if it would be possible in the circumstances which he believes or hopes exist or will exist at the relevant time. But, astonishingly, in 1985, another panel of the Law Lords, but with at last one dissenting voice, read the new statute so that it would not support convicting you of attempt to handle stolen goods if, as in the case there, you bought a consumer durable very cheaply, fully believing it to have been stolen. But there's no proof that it happened. The majority were once again swayed by Lord Reed's 1975 rhetoric and by academic argument that convicting this purchaser of non-stolen goods, of attempting to steal them, would contravene the principle of legality. But all these arguments were both viciously circular and lacking in common sense, as was admitted by the Law Lords a year and 6 days later, bringing an end to this judicial debacle, all concurring in the repentant judgment authored by the Law Lord who had given one of the judgments concurred in by four out of the five Law Lords in 1985. Well, the causes of the debacle were four, I think. First, the seductive impact of slogans held out by able counsel, rational principle, no punishment for thoughts, objectively innocent acts, the principle of legality, and so forth. Second, the force of precedent, even so dramatically mistaken and widely denounced a decision as the first in the series in 1975, exercised precedential or inertial force, only amplified because rendered by particularly strong judges using overbearing rhetoric about what is and is not asinine and calling for adherence to common law principle, no punishment for wrongful intentions, only for unlawful acts. Even though in all these cases the accused had in fact done a wealth of acts more than merely preparatory to doing what they knew would be unlawfully if accomplished. And the acts they had done and the agreements that they had made and done much or everything they could to perform were acts and agreements which, even though by chance impossible of successful accomplishment, were plainly and publicly defined in advance as unlawful, defined both by the historic common law overruled in 1975 and by Parliament's restoration of that law, and more important, of common sense, in 1977 and again in 1981. Third, blind spots in legal learning. Here we saw yet again the centuries-old and still persisting weakness of counsel and common law judges alike in reaching any refined, let alone accurate, understanding of the role of intention in identifying action. Members of a law commission advising Parliament can have more leisure and discursive opportunity to repair such gaps, more than even the highest appellate judges under the stress of their always diverse and overloaded docket of briefs to be read, arguments to be heard, and judgments to be written. And fourthly, the procedural context of litigation and appellate advocacy induced a complexification by side issues capable of determining the outcome but irrelevant to the point at stake in the proposed change in the law, or the proposed rejection or interpretative transformation of Parliament's attempted change in the law. And equally, it led to distortions, oversights, and mistaken emphases, both in the collective effort to understand the established law as potentially coherent whole, and in the assessment of the decision's impact on the community's future common good. Common good that includes not only the rights of alleged offenders to lawful procedures and the rights of their potential victims, but also the effects on potentially everyone of changed expectations, surveillance, and other precautions, and costs of many kinds. So fourthly, the problem about exercising judicial power with a view to reforming the law or to assessing the merits of legislative reforms is not merely the built-in risk of making poor judgments, but rather, I think, a problem of principle. Making law is taking responsibility for the future, a the responsibility of persons answerable for the new laws to their subjects. For discharging this responsibility, the institutional design of serious legislatures is broadly superior to the institutional design and procedures of even sophisticated appellate courts, not least because bearers of judicial power are rightly made immune from any requirement to answer for their judgments and from almost any liability for them. And in my text, I discuss with some examples a number of features of court proceedings that make them inept for lawmaking: their adversarial character, the strategic and tactical constraints on the parties and their counsel, the inequality of arms between established campaigning bodies and their state opponents, the cultural probability today of strongly reformist trial judges finding essentially legislative facts about future effects and side effects, the one-way ratchet towards reform introduced by the asymmetry between reformist judges sitting light to precedent and conservative judges according precedential weight to unsound judicial reforms. Seen in miniature in the impossible attempt cases and on a vast canvas in United States Supreme Court decisions that I discuss in the text. So fifthly, in any event, the constitutional division of authority is a matter of law. Part of the law the judge has a duty to apply, even when it establishes that a certain matter is not subject to adjudication, or that parties of certain kinds have legal rights that the judge thinks they should not have, or has obligations the judge thinks they should not have. The very last decision of the law lords was, as I've argued elsewhere, an essentially unconstitutional invasion of executive power, conferred and confirmed by our law, specifically by the Suicide Act 1961 to 2009, section 2, subsection 4, requiring the authorization of the Director of Public Prosecutions as a precondition for prosecuting any of the offences created by that statute. The premise of the Lord's judgments in Purdy against the DPP in 2009 was that to conform to the European Convention on Human Rights, our law must enable a law-abiding citizen to, and I quote, foresee the consequences of his actions so that he can regulate his conduct without breaking the law, unquote. Their conclusion and order, however, was in substance that the DPP must give guidance to citizens contemplating breaking the law about suicide so that they can foresee the consequences of their law breaking. So as the courts below saw, this was not only declaring a Human Rights Act convention right unhinged from the convention and from the decisions of its judicial organ in Strasbourg, but also was trying to square the constitutional circle to make judicial power, exercised without warrant of law, supreme over an executive power fully warranted by statute. The Purdy judgments about the DPP's duty conceive of themselves as resting on the principle of legality, the rule of law. So too did the Supreme Court's majority judgments in Evans this year, setting aside the clear statutory effect of the Attorney General's certificate about the Prince of Wales correspondence. But in each case, the Court's treatment of the real constitutional or enacted rules is so implausible, so extravagantly protrusting, that the persons given clear statutory responsibility, and more importantly, the Parliament that conferred it, and the interested informed public, are all correct to see these as decisions that confuse the rule of law and legality with the rule of judges. Purdy should have been challenged and overruled in the next Supreme Court case about assisting suicide, Nicholson, in 2014. But counsel and the interveners, doubtless for strategic or tactical reasons, chose not to do so. And that's one manifestation of a somewhat wider institutional problem, which extends beyond judicial change or development of the law, and bedevils even judicial application of straightforward and uncontested legal obligations, including obligations imposed specifically on the courts themselves. I mean, the problem of concessions by counsel. Many illustrations of this problem could be given. I choose one. A, against the Home Secretary, 2005, the famous Belmarsh prisoners case. Because it was, in my respectful opinion, a juridical disaster of at least the equal of the Lord's impossible attempt cases, in fallacious reasoning and manifest error, And because these have gone almost unnoticed by a commentary that applauds the apparently, as I'll show, only apparently liberal result. It involved an appellate committee of almost unparalleled strength, 9-4. But until this grand and almost universally applauded decision is recognised as the error it was, little in our constitutional practice will appear. Because it's the flagship case of today's British human rights law movement, and is given some prominence in the book The Rule of Law by Lord Bingham, who presided in it, a book that applicants to read law in Cambridge and Oxford all read. I've set it out and argued my critique over 2 or 3 pages in the copy of this lecture that's available to text. So here's a short version. At the end of over 200 paragraphs of judgments, the House of Lords declared that section 23 of the post-9/11 Anti-Terrorism Crime and Security Act 2001 was incompatible with the rights to liberty and equality guaranteed in the European Convention. Section 23 is very short and consists of 2 subsections. The second, which controls the first, is never quoted in any judgment, never discussed in the reported argument of counsel, and has the effect of providing that the detention authorised by Section 23 is only pending deportation. What that phrase, pending deportation, means was explained, if confirmation were needed, by a very high-profile decision of the High Court of Australia decided 2 months earlier than the argument and 4 months earlier than the decision in the Belmarsh prisoners' case, but never mentioned by anyone in Belmarsh. It means that at the outset of detention, and every 3 months thereafter, the extension of our High Court called the Special Immigration Appeals Tribunal, SIAC, would have to be satisfied not only that the appellant's detention was justified by the reasonableness of the suspicion that they were terrorists and by the reasonableness of the assessment that their presence in the United Kingdom was still a threat to national security, but also by a demonstration that the government was trying to deport them and taking good faith measures to overcome the legal and practical obstacles to deporting them. In the absence of such a demonstration of ongoing real efforts to deport, the detention would be unlawful under Section 23(2). But Section 23(2)'s obvious meaning, implications, and legal effect were never discussed or even noticed in the House of Lords proceedings. Nor was there the slightest mention of the possible applicability to it of Section 3 of the Human Rights Act, which imposes on the courts a duty not to declare any statutory provision to be incompatible with convention rights without first interpreting that provision so far as possible to be compatible, an interpretative exercise which the courts routinely perform with enthusiasm and often with plausibility. The Lords declared Section 23 incompatible without for a minute considering their Section 3 duty, or the obvious possibility of reading Section 23 compatibly with the Liberty and Equality Convention rights in the way I did a moment ago. They denounced the section as unlawful on the premise that it authorised detention of foreigners if their detention was impossible, just as deportation of British nationals is impossible. As the Lords then ruled, it is irrational and discriminatory to lock up foreign terrorists you cannot deport, while leaving free homegrown terrorists you cannot deport. But Section 23, with or without the compulsory but forgotten Section 3 interpretative exercise, meant that detention of foreign terrorists is lawful only so long as their deportation, though temporarily or indefinitely prevented, is a possibility being actively and in good faith pursued. Well, how could all this happen? In part because of inept concessions and oversights by counsel for the government. Yes, true, the concessions were made by the Attorney General in the government that promoted this legislation. But how could that be reason for the Lords not to look behind the concessions to the terms of the 2 Acts of Parliament in front of them? This is not the Tudor world in which the government is taken to make and unmake law by proclamation. Government ministers had no authority whatsoever to change the meaning of Section 23 by concession, let alone by silent, unacknowledged concession or omission to defend, and no authority whatever to license the court to leave Section 3 of the Human Rights Act unmentioned. nor could any ministerial concession make it fitting for the judgments to leave Parliament and the country in ignorance that the appellate committee had simply not done what being seen to do justice according to law required of it, namely, perform its Section 3 duty of seeking to read Section 23 compatibly with the Convention before declaring it incompatible. So this flagship case is a ghost ship, in reality a shipwreck, as an application of law to fact, a total loss. So far from the result being truly liberal, the applicants were not even given what they were legally entitled to, though adeptly hadn't asked for it, namely a ruling that they could not be detained unless SIAC found every 3 months that their deportation was still a possibility being actively pursued, as in fact it was. The constitutional irregularity of this very high-level exercise of judicial power, in which the deviation from the rule of law was all on the judicial side and not at all on the legislative or executive, is quite troubling. This sort of constitutionally dubious exercise of judicial power nearly happened again last year in Nicholson, when the Supreme Court, again nine strong for the occasion, got close, fairly close, to declaring the Suicide Act partly incompatible with the European Convention Rights of Private Life, omitting to note anywhere in the many long judgments that since the Suicide Act is wholly compatible with convention rights and the UK's convention obligations, as they have been authoritatively declared by the highest organ of the convention, the Strasbourg Court, any certificate or declaration of incompatibility would be misleading unless on its face it carefully informed Parliament that the certified incompatibility was not with convention rights, meaning rights under or by virtue of the convention, but only with rights which the Human Rights Act somehow allows our judiciary to discover and then label convention rights. These reflections on several decisions by our highest courts help illustrate other theses I want to propose tonight. Here's a set of negative theses. The content of our Constitution was not and is not established by the judges, though it could not and cannot be established without their ratification. Lord Steyne's dictum in Jackson against the Attorney General that the judges created the supremacy of Parliament. The supremacy of Parliament is still the general principle of our Constitution, but judges created this principle. Should be simply rejected, along with its suggested corollary that what they created, they can abolish. What Cook was doing in the case of proclamations did not become part of the Constitution until it was adopted by the polity, by a process that includes the petition of right he drew up for his fellow MPs to present to the King in 1628, the Civil War Parliament, and then the Glorious Revolution. So, seventhly, it's not true that the courts are the forum of rights and principle, and the legislature the forum of interests or welfare. And eighthly, it's not the case that the legislature is to promote the will of the majority and the courts to protect minorities. Each of that pair of thoughts, much promoted by my old colleague Ronald Dworkin, misapprehends both sides of the contract. Legislatures ought to be constantly concerned with both the legal and the moral rights of all within the protection and obligation of their enactments. Courts ought to be constantly concerned to uphold the legal rights of the parties before them, whether there stands behind one or other of them, vast numbers of others in like case, or very few. Nine, in maturely self-determined polities with a discursively deliberative legislature, it's not wise, I suggest, to require or permit judges to exercise the essentially non-judicial responsibility of overriding or even of condemning legislation for its not being necessary or for its disproportionality relative to open-ended rights and the needs of a democratic society. Proportionate suggests a far more rigorous algorithm of criteria than is in fact all law available. The very considerable imprecision is manifested by the fact that after operating for about a decade with a three-step process of assessment, our courts have in the last few years suddenly taken to deploying four steps and visibly treat the new fourth step as in practice the most important of them all, despite its novelty. The old set comprised, first, a legitimate aim or end in the legislation, secondly, means effective for that end, with, thirdly, the smallest negative side impact on other rights and interests. The recent edition is of, four, proportionality in the strict sense, so-called, meaning that, all things considered, the pursuit of this aim by these means is reasonable, having regard not only to the harm done by the measure's side effects, but also to the harm that would be done by not pursuing the aim at all, or at any rate by these or comparable means. All these criteria, and most obviously the suddenly popular fourth one, involve matters of fact, including counterfactuals and evaluative opinion, in which legal learning is of little assistance and forensically ascertainable evidence is unavailable. Though judicial competence can be deployed in applying a proportionality test to some classes of executive decision within the context of a dense web of legal rules, whether legislative or common law in origin, and culturally and conventionally established expectations, there is little or nothing judicial, nothing law applying, about assessments of proportionality in relation to rights such as those in the European Convention, when these assessments are made by courts coming fresh to them in the context of general legislative or legislatively approved arrangements for social rights. And the resulting arbitrariness could be illustrated in many, many ways. It's well illustrated, for example, by the Strasbourg Court's proportionality assessments of the law disenfranchising convicted prisoners while in prison. Proportionality doctrine is inherently incapable of justifying judicial declarations that there is a legally and therefore judicially discernible line between a revocable lifetime disenfranchisement, like Italy's, acceptable to the court, and a disqualification while in prison serving a criminal sentence in prison, like Britain's, applicable to about 8% of convicted persons, and therefore only sophisticatedly called, as it is called by the court, a blank ballot. Each has the same rational basis, each of those laws, and only an exercise of legislative power can make a choice between such rationally and morally acceptable alternatives. If a court is given the power to declare such a lie, it is being given a power that is inherently legislative, not judicial. This was all shown with scrupulous care in 2011 by Justice Hayden, a bencher of this inn and alumnus of University College Oxford, who did his bar exams with me in 1970, and was called the same autumn with me. In a dissenting judgment in the High Court of Australia's first appeal involving the State of Victoria's Charter of Rights, I pause to say that Hayden's judgments characteristically show, to my mind, the exercise of judicial power in authentic, admirable form, requiring of the judge meticulous, unremitting attention to the facts as properly pleaded or established, to the procedural architecture, to the arguments the parties made, and sometimes those that might well have been made by them and can now be considered without unfairness or surprise, to the applicable rules of law in their detail, nuance, and clarifying relation to principle, and to our law's principles themselves, though with prudent caution against the seductions of premature or sophistical simplicities and rhetoric, along with independence of mind, strong against lazy groupthink inside the court and the pressures of power and opinion outside it. And despite all I've said tonight, these virtues are of course in evidence in many courts and are a foundation of that workmanlike rule of law which has underpinned the markets of an entrepreneurial society and has made English law and by implication English courts and judges and counsel as arbitrators the favoured choice of law and jurisdiction in contracts all over the world. But to go back to proportionality, this 2011 judgment of Justice Hayden shows in detail how Victoria's Charter, modelled on statutes like our Human Rights Act, requires the court to assess legislation's proportionality by rights-related criteria, so many, so vague, so diverse if not conflicting, and so open-ended to views about the future, that the judge can only be exercising a parallel or overriding legislative and not judicial power. And I would add only that what's wrong with conferring that power, even in the watered-down form of a declaration leaving a statute in force until repeal, is that when the court draws the legislative line, its constitutional status and jurisdiction obliges it to claim or imply that it is simply echoing and transmitting the voice of the law, our law as it was laid down in the past. In fact, it, or some earlier judicial decision on the same point, is making a choice for the whole community's future, but without responsibility for that future or answerability for that choice. The claim or implication that it is choosing by applying our law is make-believe, as is the claim to be better equipped than the legislature to make such a choice. The true legislators are then forced either to go along with this make-believe and accept the humiliating status of violators setting right their violations of human rights, or to reject the judicial finding and be taken by the people to be claiming to know the law better than the judges. This is corrupting of constitutional understanding all round. Leaving aside the results, anyone who reads those of the opinions in our Supreme Court in Mitchinson that question the proportionality of the Suicides Act prohibition of assisting suicide, and in two cases try to draft or sketch an alternative, and who then reads the debates on the same matter in the House of Lords and the House of Commons subsequent to Nicholson, will, I think, conclude that although few, if any, of the legislators had attended to or read or gained from the Nicholson judgments, the overall quality of the legislators' engagement with the issues truly at stake, one way or the other, was in each of the houses hugely superior. The learning deployed in the judgments is simply not well adapted to getting to the issues, the resolution of which will affect the community's whole life in the ways that either retaining or amending that law does. So, tenthly, in maturely self-determined polities with a discursively deliberative legislature, it's not wise to allow courts to constitute themselves roving law reform commissions like the European Court of Human Rights, European Court of Justice, the Supreme Court of the United States, and the Supreme Court of Canada, and increasingly the United Kingdom Supreme Court. The doctrine which these courts articulate to explain and justify doing so is that the constitutional convention or other instrument which they are responsible for applying is a living tree, Canadian phrase, or living instrument, European Convention phrase, the Strasbourg phrase. For judges to apply old, as in year-old, century-old statutes, constitutions, or treaty conventions to new situations and conditions is right, provided the new situation or condition falls within the categories picked out by the propositions expressed in the statute or other instrument, even if the new instances of these categories were not envisaged at the time of enactment. But it's wrong, I believe, for judges to apply newly current values, ideas about good and bad, right and wrong, to ensure that an old situation, old because the instrument's original makers intended their instrument to deal with that kind of situation, whether by inclusion or exclusion, in a certain way, to ensure that an old situation will now be dealt with in a way that is new and incompatibly different. And it's the latter, the new answer to old kinds of situation, that's what's meant or connoted by living instrument. The great monument to living instrument interpretation, there are many, the great one is the Strasbourg Court's creation of a huge body of rights of asylum law. In the context of the convention, quite certainly intended to contain no right to asylum. This body of law has been created by way of living instrument interpretation of Article 3's prohibition of torture or inhuman or degrading treatment. I trace in detail both the origins and meaning of the living instrument doctrine and the cases that transform Article 3 into a right not to be returned to a country where the returnee might be ill-treated in any of those three ways. It all culminates in the remarkable 2011 case, Herzi Jamal, an important cause among complex causes of today's migration crisis. There the Grand Chamber unanimously outlawed all and any policies like Italy's policy, agreed with Libya, of pushing back migrant boats with their occupants to the country of departure. If such boats might contain, among the hundreds aboard, even a handful of persons, or one person, who might be at real risk, if returned to Libya, of being sent from Libya to some country where he might be at real risk of degrading or other ill treatment from the government or actually from anyone, then all the boat's passengers must be allowed to land in Italy. And this, the court insists in its usual bland, inexplicit way, is an exceptionless rule, an absolute, from which there can be no derogation even if the life of the nation were to be certainly imperiled by the importation of Ebola or other plague, or of uncountable numbers of terrorists or others intent on overthrowing by force or numbers the state and the convention. The court's living interpretation of Article 3 jams the door open. Yet the records of the drafting of the Refugee Convention just after the completion of the European Convention on Human Rights by essentially the same founding states make it as clear as could possibly be that all the states which indicated their intentions intended to exclude from the Refugee Convention anything that might prevent them from closing their borders to mass migration from any country. It is certain that Article 3 was intended, and surely rightly, to exclude from the conduct of its member states and their agents, absolutely and exceptionlessly, even if the nation and its life were in peril, every subjection of anyone to torture or to inhuman or degrading behavior. But it's also certain that if you think that what an exceptionalist moral rule law prohibits should extend beyond what the acting person or group intends, and so you try to make the norm exceptionalistly prohibit also whatever that person or group foresees as a side effect of their acts, you will make the norm self-contradictory, as I argue in the text. But the point tonight is only that this is all judicial legislation, an abuse, as the oft-dissenting British judge Fitzmaurice demonstrated time and again when the living instrument doctrine was being invented. An abuse even when the stakes are nothing like as high. The crisis that European countries are beginning to live, is one for which the Strasbourg Court, as is rarely recalled, has a substantial responsibility. Its errors are no comedy, but a kind of nemesis. From this court of error or appeal, nor any other kind of means of liberation has been made available or is specifically proposed as yet. It's not a nemesis that my argument relies upon, but it shouldn't be passed over in silence, easier though that would be for us all here and now. So, I'm reaching the end without entering at all into any of the concrete questions currently up for deliberation. Now, changing our arrangements in relation to the important courts, treaties, and statutes that I've mentioned. The modern features of the exercise of judicial responsibility go wider, and it's good, I think, to reflect on them and discuss them frankly. Thinking about the future of judicial power on the basis primarily of the social capital of our own legal, civil, and political culture, main elements of which are mirrored for us far and wide in the world, there's much that might be said, and I make only one or two interrelated remarks at this late stage. The judicial independence that was so outside in the days of Cook and Bacon was, a century later, in 1701, made secure against executive power in return for an implicit acknowledgement of the supremacy of Parliament's legislative power over directly both the executive and the existing law, and thus indirectly over the responsible bearers of judicial power. This people, unlike many others, thus resolved that in its constitution, that supreme power, which inevitably carries with it the risk that it may be exercised unwisely or unjustly, would for all purposes and unambiguously be located in the Crown in Parliament. Within that framework, respect for historic rights is entrusted to parliamentary authority and under that authority to the judges. The newly independent judges are to be, in Bacon's words, lions, fearless upholders of law in face of every private or public blandishment or pressure. That complex, balanced constitutional settlement was hard won. Its merits are confirmed, I suggest, by continued experience, including not only some that I've recalled this evening, homegrown or nearby, but also some at a distance of alternatives, such as the American or now the Canadian, where the constitutional power and self-confident aggrandizement of Supreme Courts noticeably, and it seems increasingly, outruns their competence and care. The merits of our basic constitutional settlement are decreasingly accepted and decreasingly well understood, certainly in the legal academy, but I think at the bar and, I sense and sometimes see, on the bench. While there is healthy talk of differing institutional competences, it needs to be accompanied by assessments of the judicial competence and responsibility that are really balanced and attentive to the fundamental constitution-shaping political normative fact that everyone, each of us living our lives across time, is a minority in need of justice and representation. Why, then, is the drift everywhere towards the subjection of legislative power, directly or indirectly, to judicial power? Why do many judges in many jurisdictions ever more confidently give judgments assuming the roles of constitution makers and legislators? Well, answers must remain speculative. The causes are various. One cause is hidden in that word jurisdiction I used just then when I meant countries, political and civic communities of households, families, people. Discourse in law schools and courts increasingly locates its participants in a universe of standards of correct thought and decision and of the incorrect and unacceptable, which are generated and shared among persons who speak as if they were nowhere in particular. And they can carry on this discourse and make, commend or recommend the corresponding judicial decisions for whole countries and sets of countries with amazingly little pushback by those whom our constitution still firmly designate as the makers of the law that shapes its people's future. Why is some pushback in order? Why was and is that historic constitutional distribution of responsibilities sound? Well, one way of putting a sound answer is this: pushback seeking to adaptively restore that constitutional distribution is timely and fitting because the members of a properly functioning legislature, chosen by persons who with their families will be affected, have to look each other in the eye even while they are deciding, with no pretense that their decision is anything other than what it is, their personal choice of one kind of future in preference to all others, for themselves, their fellow legislators, and the people they represent and live among. They do not and cannot make the claim that bearers of judicial power must at least profess that this decision of ours about the law merely or essentially conveys, transmits into the present and the future positions that have already been settled by our law and are found in it by a learned art, Cook's artificial reason, called interpretation, applying commitments made, at least in principle, back in the past, or interpreting and applying commitments made, it is professed, over there, in a haze of global law, made how, by whom, no one really can say, but identifiable and professable as rights and standards, even by scholars and judges who, in another conversation, eye to eye, might well admit their doubt or denial that there is really any moral right or wrong, their sophisticated belief that no value judgments are true or subjective. That discourse community, or academic NGO judicial echo chamber, treats as strangers the legislators in merely local assemblies such as national parliaments, and the politicians taken to be persons who are unskilled in that learned discourse and its latest tropes and precepts, who fail to measure themselves against the standards of esteem or disesteem that prevail in a given decade in that community or echo chamber. There's urgent need, then, for legislators who have retained or regained their sense of constitutional place and legitimacy, and you are aware that this whole style of movement of global juridical discourse and judicial reformism is, like judicial process even at its best, a defective, inferior way for a historically constitutionally minded people to take responsibility for its own future. Legislators and scholars and commentators who understand the lessons of our history should also be aware, I think, as I've outlined some of the evidence for holding, that contemporary expansionist adjudication constantly results in judgments which are, by legal learning's own standards, shipwrecks. Not because novel in their results, but because by those very standards of legal, including constitutional learning, they are fallacious. Legislators and commentators need to be aware, and scholars, despite their rather monochrome political preferences, need more frankly to admit that judicial judgments about legislative proportionality or programmatic rights are bound to be flawed, and often very deeply flawed, even or perhaps especially when they are reconceived not so much as final judgments resolving disputes between parties, but as would-be contributions to an ongoing legislative conversation, dialogue. Finally, we all, lawyers and non-lawyers alike, should be aware how much work we indispensably need the courts and their judges to do. As I said, they've long been doing it. So that in fidelity to real law, applied to proven or admitted facts, they even-handedly restrain those individuals and groups who wield any of the many, many kinds of private or public power, including the power of media pressure, groupthink, and ostracism, to keep them within the specific bounds and measures of our genuinely established laws and settled commitments, and to compensate those who have been unlawfully wronged. Until the slow fever of judicial expansionism is cooled, doing justice according to law will call in a special way for something else which Dyson Hayden's Inner Temple lecture on judicial independence put in words of Lord Bingham. Judicial independence involves independence from one's colleagues. Thank you very much.
We have time, happily, for Professor Finnis to answer some questions, so I'll do my best to keep an orderly queue. If you can announce who you are and where you come from, perhaps, organisation, that would be awfully helpful. There are people with microphones to assist you. So we have a question up front here.
Sometimes generate the problem for themselves, but in these cases, like in Delmarsh, they were presented with it. Of course, what I said went beyond just, well beyond, in the case of Delmarsh, just that they were given an inappropriate task. Indeed, that task didn't involve questions of proportionality. Liberty and equality were the issues, and only rather peripherally was proportionality in question in the case, and in essentially, I think. But still, they made a tremendous hash of the task that they were given. And that was partly because of the task being wide and vague, as to some extent human rights like liberty or certainly equality are. And so it's a task that is in some respects going to be legislative in character. But it was partly because the structure of the court proceedings with confession of counsel, that was a particular point that I was drawing attention to, which distort the whole course and outcome of the proceedings. So I agree with you that the problem is, at least in significant part, in some respects in large part, with the conferral of this responsibility inappropriately on the judges.
So we have a second question. Sorry, up this way. No, second row. Second row.
Joshua Rosenberg, I'm a journalist. Can I suggest an answer to the question you asked towards the end of your lecture, where you were suggesting, or asking what the judges thought they were up to while they were behaving in the way that you outlined? It's a very obvious answer, it's in the judicial oath. They think they're doing justice. And what should a judge do, I'm thinking of appellate judges in this country, if they're faced with two arguments, two sides, one you might characterize as an originalist approach, a strict approach of the, to interpreting the legislation, and the other a more innovative, more creative, more imaginative approach, which you would generally condemn. And they come to the conclusion that both are equally valid interpretations of the legislation, but the second one would do justice. Not only would it do justice, but it would deal with the problem, you mentioned assisted suicide, which Parliament is very reluctant to deal with, but one which, if it chose to, it could deal with, in the sense that it could always overrule the judges. So what should the judges do if they feel that they have two options, both of them are acceptable, one will do justice and the other will not?
Well, saying that they're both acceptable, that the one is justice, the other one, not justice, I'm not sure that that's a fully coherent question. To say that the one that you're not calling just is, however, acceptable, is what I would say, is it being just in significant respects, otherwise it would be unacceptable. So I think the question is difficult to grasp. But let's just put it slightly differently. If there are two acceptable ways forward, as clearly there are in many, many cases, like negligence, in some sense of acceptable, then I think what the four judges around Lord Sumption's judgment do, which is to step back and say, and this is not something that that at least three of the other five completely ignore, it's not. But the four around Lord Sumption to step back and say, look, this is something that Parliament has dealt with, contrary to what you suggested or the way you put it, Mr. Rosenberg, the Parliament has not shown itself reluctant to deal with it, constantly debates this. It's been debated in the House of Lords so many times. It's been the subject of major parliamentary inquiries. So its so-called reluctance to deal with it is in fact a judgment that the law is sound. And it's a repeated judgment, and we've just had it repeated again. But it's been repeated in one house or the other constantly, and so it's just a kind of reformist rhetoric to say that Parliament is unwilling to deal with it. It constantly deals with it. It reenacted the Suicide Act 1961, the tough clauses in it, in 2009, and slightly it's tightened them up. It's completely false to say that Parliament is unwilling to deal with this. It doesn't give the answer that the reformers would like. So a judge who is on the reformist side, and why shouldn't he or she be? I can give some reasons, but you know, there are reasons that reasonable people can disagree about, condition of the vulnerable and so forth and so forth. A judge on the reformist side should, I think, step back and say, this is something that our constitution has conferred on Parliament as the seat of a responsible judgment. Of this highly significant kind, with ramifications that extend far beyond the parties that I can see in front of me, affecting every family in the country one way or the other for the indefinite future. I'm not the person, we're not the set of people who are charged with taking this responsibility on. And that, I think, is a sufficient reason for being with the conservative side in the judiciary, and then step out to the House of Lords and cast your vote for the amendment of the law.
We have another question here, and then 2 rows back. So, no, the gentleman up here. I'm sorry, the second one here.
Regarding the academic judicial echo chamber, which is a possible reason for why we're seeing this wave of judicial expansion. So also, can you talk a little bit about what you think the academy might do to try to rectify this situation? Is it in fact possible to do this?
Well, the academy needs to keep talking. I mean, so we're talking about a kind of change of mind, change of understanding, deeper understanding of the issues, and the only way that can be accomplished is by people thinking more deeply and changing their minds. So all we can do is keep talking, and some talk, be talking, and be writing about this. And no, I'm not alone, of course. I can see faces around me of my colleagues in the academy, but that's what scholars to do, to not just join bandwagon. And not just go for the results that they like, but think about everything that they're actually educated to understand more deeply than people who in right good faith, go out and campaign for good causes, as they think good causes. Namely, to think about the location of that good cause in the whole structure of the polity and of the whole culture, which we scholars have got the leisure and means to consider as a whole and in its principles. And so to make the effort to discover the historical roots and to discover the philosophical, you might call them, roots of distinctions between right and wrong. And to try and get conscientious about whether you really do believe in human rights if you think all value judgments are relative, which is what your school teachers told you. So coming out of schools where you're taught that all value judgments just subjective, you've got to change your mind. You can only do that by thinking more deeply and as it were, reading and talking your way into it. So that's what's needed.
It's a question of 2 rows behind, so if you could pass the microphone. Okay. Thank you very much.
I'm Alex Carr, I'm a member of the House of Lords, and I'm very much involved in the assisted dying debate. As a parliamentarian in one or other House of Parliament for the last 32 years, I'm tempted to put to you that abandoning the living instrument approach would shock above all members of both Houses of Parliament. That either the genie is out of the bottle or the genie is mutated into something else. But now parliamentarians, I believe, expect the judges to be involved in the living instrument approach. rely on the judges to be more purposive and interpretative than they used to be. One of the causes of that may be the Human Rights Act, but whatever the government does with the Human Rights Act, the reality is it's not going to remove any rights. So we are where we are, and I don't believe myself, as I suggested, that this is correct, that we can abandon the purposive or genie out of the bottle approach now.
Well, there's a nest of sort of factual and predictive issues there, and I don't dispute at all for a moment the reasons to your judgment. I share it, that it's unlikely things are going to be turned around in any very significant way. Of course, it's sensible for people, members of Parliament, to have accepted what's happened. It only started in 1975, the Living Instrument Doctrine in Strasbourg. Of course, it's in other places go back a bit further, but not radically further. There's always been the purpose of interpretation of one sort or another. But Living Instrument applied to big constitutional issues and convention-type issues is a relatively new thing, and judges at the outset were protesting against it. Anyway, the genie is out of the bottle, and so parliamentarians are advised good that they make the best of it and take what advice they can get from the judges. But what I was encouraging was a very keen awareness that the judges who are giving them this living instrument interpretation are very likely, or quite likely, to be making a hash of it. And so a sort of confidence amongst the members of Parliament that they can understand the instrument, the actual one, as well as or better than the judges in its true implications, and that the judicial interpretation may well be one that has arisen because of these quasi-accidental factors that I sort of mentioned, counsel's concessions and so forth and so on. And then get stuck by virtue of precedent. And so tracing the way in which Strasbourg has got itself into the position that it has in relation to Britain's voting right, not a hugely important issue, but it's very, very instructive to read the judges. Their appalling quality, their opposition to each other, their unintelligible final position with Italy and Britain contrasted in the way they are. And the, in itself, absurd position of the Strasbourg Court, that they won't overrule their own ruling against Britain in the original case, because, well, that would somehow affect the dignity of judicial proceedings, even though they have abandoned the actual reasoning in Hearst itself. It's fine, I think, if parliamentarians say, okay, that's the living instrument interpretation of the Convention. It's basically rubbish, and if we can work around it and not be bemused by it, not really accept it as what judicial judgments are meant to be, namely a dispassionate interpretation of the law as it was said, but something else, partly accidental, partly idealistic, misconceived in various ways, okay, then that's a good way to go forward, and possible, right here and now.
Well, to bring this evening to a close, I'm afraid all questions will not be answered this evening. I'm very pleased to invite Lord Justice Elias to give a brief vote. Justice Elias.
Well, thank you. Those of you who expected the Lord Chancellor will also perceive I'm not the Lord Chancellor. Can I say, I thought that was a tour de force. I thought it was a terrific lecture. I'll tell you what I really like about it. I think Professor Finnis is one of the outstanding legal intellects of our time. But he is wholly independent. I would say a rigorous intellect. In fact, I'd say a ruthless intellect. Because he takes no prisoners. I think a lot of judges will have come here tonight with hard hats, and perhaps armour as well. Talking about Lord Reed, being very critical of Lord Reed, an asinine decision. A, fallacious reasoning and manifest error. But these aren't, if I may say so, just idle or offensive terms. They're built up because he analyzes the cases with very considerable care, with great intellect. You may disagree, but if you're going to disagree, you have to think very hard, and you have to know why you're disagreeing. And if I may say so, I think what he says, personally, what he says about proportionality is entirely right. You're comparing apples and pears, and why on the whole are judges any better than anyone else? Although it has to be said, judges are required to do this task. But maybe judges do have to appreciate their own limitations and recognize that perhaps the whole of the Constitution wasn't meant to be undermined by concepts of proportionality, and some recognition of what is properly legislative and what is properly judicial has to inform the proportionality exercise. I in fact remember meeting Professor Finnis, he won't remember this, but a long time ago when I was a junior barrister and I was being led by Derry Irvine, later Lord Irvine, and we were instructed by Lord Goodman on behalf of an Oxford academic against his college. And we go to Lord Goodman's flat, I remember, in Portman Square on a Sunday, on two or three occasions. And he brought along with him Dr. Finnis, as he then was, I believe, because he perfectly properly thought he'd get much better advice from Dr. Finnis than he would from Lord Irvine. I think we were being marked. I've never asked what our mark was, and perhaps I shouldn't do that. And the other book I thought was outstanding when I was teaching jurisprudence, amongst other things, in Cambridge, very badly, was Natural Law and Natural Rights. Again, if you want to see a really independent mind, you have somebody who engages with traditional jurisprudence, engages with Aquinas, engages with religious value issues, and tries to explore law from that angle. And it is extremely enriching, it is extremely well written, of course. And again, you may disagree with it, but you have to think hard why, and it forces you to engage with your own thoughts, your own assumptions, and your own preconceptions. And that, I think, is what a scholar should do more than anything else. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much.